Can I interest you in a Victory Friday edition of CBD right here on 850 WKNR? At their best, sports unites us. At their best. Politically, generationally, you can have disagreements in anything else, but a win for your team is the tie that binds, and we had one in Northeast Ohio last night that was special, that will live on forever, and a giant monkey has been taken off of the back of the franchise, certainly. That is for Stan and Tom and Parma, Bob and Bentleyville, Brent and Strongsville, Sarah and Cleveland, Vern and Chardon, everybody else like them. It's for the Hall of Famer, future to be, Joe Thomas, who joins me. I am Beau Bishop. Joe, can I interest you in a Victory Friday?
You can, man. I'm getting goosebumps just listening to that broadcast all over again, as if I'm standing there on the sideline like I did last night. I just cannot believe the way that that game unfolded. The way that it started in the first quarter and a half, and it looked like it was going to be a blowout, unfortunately, in the Jets' favor. And all of a sudden, the young star comes in and leads the team back from a 14-3 deficit and looks almost flawless the entire game and leads them to their first victory in over 2 years. Just totally stunning.
Because of past history, there has been a reluctance, I think, from some to fully wrap their arms around Baker and hug him. And I said this about a month ago on the show. I said, you can hug him. You can embrace him. Like, he's not going to let you down. He is who you think he is. He is the prince who was promised. I'd really believe that. It was incredible to see it manifest. You've played in the league a long time, Joe. You've seen a million quarterback situations, obviously. Veteran or rookie, have you ever seen anybody come into a spot like that? Down 14, in prime time, under the lights, an angry stadium, let's acknowledge it, it was, and flip the script like that.
I've never seen anybody inject so much energy into a team and into a stadium as when Baker came into that game. You know, throughout my career, I've played with a lot of first-round quarterbacks that had a lot of hype. I mean, I still remember ringing in my ears, Johnny, Johnny, you know, a few years ago calling for Johnny Manziel. But I think you're exactly right. I think everything we've seen from Baker tells us that this is not a false messiah. This guy is legitimately a franchise quarterback that's going to resurrect this Cleveland Browns franchise.
Joe, as high of expectations as I had for him, and I acknowledge I've had a bit of a man crush.
It's okay. You can say that.
I can say it out loud. Like, he had my Heisman vote early on last year, and I'll never forget him going into the horseshoe and just the way that people followed him. And there was a Jarvis Landry last night in the press conference had this great line where they said, did you have any doubt? And almost incredulously, Jarvis says, no doubt. About six? No doubt.
No
about
doubt.
Six.
No doubt.
I mean, this is that? And by the way, the guy who he replaced is a captain of the football team who was the unquestioned starter.
Yeah.
He's the unquestioned starter.
Yeah.
And he was the captain of the football team. And Baker, as we know, next to nothing with the ones. He goes in at the end. I just think of the position you're put in at the end of the first half, down 14, and to respond like that. And for a guy like Jarvis to have that type of confidence in him, and Joe, maybe I'm reading into it. You were down on field level, obviously, with doing your work on NFL Network. It just seemed like everybody was like, okay, all right, let's go, six.
It really helped that when he got in there, they were in the two-minute drive. And so the Jets were playing their kind of generic two-minute zone defenses, and Baker came in, and he zings it right in there with confidence on his first throw. And then he hits another guy on his next throw, and all of a sudden the whole team was looking at him like, this guy's ready.
Yeah.
You know, you instantly, any doubt that you had in your mind as a player, it was gone because he came in that huddle with confidence like this was his 10th year in the NFL, and he knew that he was going to lead that team to victory. And that's what's awesome about having a guy that was so successful as he was when he was in college, and a guy that's really had to work his way up from the bottom. Everywhere he's gone, he's been doubted. He went into that huddle last night with no doubt. There was not a shred of doubt in his mind he was going to go in there and lead this team to victory. Although everybody in that stadium has had a lot of doubt in their mind when they've seen those rookie quarterbacks, and they want to believe that Baker's the guy. There's no doubt in that guy's mind.
No, no. I mean, he had a great line in the post game on NFL Network I was watching. Well, you asked the question.
I appreciate
you
that.
You asked a great question.
I try to be a question master.
You did a great job on the question. Yeah, you look great in that suit, too.
Oh, thanks.
You asked the question to him. You said, how did you have the confidence? And Baker's answer was, it's what I've done all my life.
Yep.
Was no one thought I could play.
Yep.
You know, I had to earn everything that I've gotten. And so people have doubted me. And it's weird for a number one overall pick to have that type of doubt. But he did, and it was tangible. And he said, this is what I've done.
this is who I am. I'm ready for these moments. And he was. And I thought the way he handled himself with you guys on the NFL Network postgame.
I was just going to mention that.
He's cutting a cake while he's answering questions. Joe, he deferred. He quickly brought up Tyrod instantly. He quickly mentioned Carlos's big game and how that helped. Gave credit to Jarvis and his receivers and the defense. There was, you think about how many guys that we've seen in a moment like that where then the moment would swallow them. Mm-hmm. Not him.
You know, sitting next to him and asking him those questions in postgame, I really wanted to see how he was going to respond and react.
Sure.
Because it's easy, you know, rookie, young kid, all of a sudden, like you mentioned, getting swallowed up, either emotionally good or bad.
Yeah.
And I don't think emotionally you want to see your quarterback react one way or the other too much, right? It's okay to get passionate, right? But after a big win like that, it's, all right, back to work. What are we going to do tomorrow? It's praise my teammates. It's make sure that the focus, it should rightfully be so, be on Baker Mayfield, but he was deferring to his teammates. That was such a good thing to see, and that reminded me a lot of a guy like Tom Brady. When I think about how Tom Brady approaches the game, his workmanlike, almost a factory mentality, right? I'm punching the clock. I'm taking emotion out of this, and I'm going to do my job to the best of my ability. To get that out of a quarterback that's a rookie that just did the impossible on Thursday Night Football, one of the biggest stages in pro football in a New York market, I mean, that's probably going to go down as the highest-rated Thursday night game they've had probably since they started playing Thursday Night Football maybe, 12, 13 years ago. And he acted like, this is what I'm supposed to do.
Give you an idea of the odds against him. Just think about this for a second. I saw Ed Werder tweet this out. It blew my mind. Mm. The Browns were 1-72-1 when trailing by 14 points since 2008.
Wow.
When he was handed the ball, it was 14-0.
Wow. And at that point, the Browns had been able to do almost nothing on offense. I mean, they had a couple good runs at that point. They were just starting to get the run game going a little bit. But other than that, they had no passing yards. They just did not look like an NFL offense at that point, and he just provided that incredible spark.
Yeah, no, it was. OBM Hot Topics, Ohio Business Machine, preferred copier provider of the Cleveland Browns of all the X's and O's for your office. Call 216-45-2000 or visit ohiobusinessmachines.com. We will get back to Baker in a second. Obviously, you're going to spend a lot of time talking about six as this show goes along. We're going to do it with you a little bit later on in the show, too. We'll get your chance to look, this is everybody's win. Everybody gets a feel of this, and you deserve all of it. You've been through it, and it's not just the one win, though, guys. I really feel, Joe, that this once this happened, the Browns were the better team the first 2 weeks.
Yep.
They didn't get W's,
I agree.
But they were the better team the first 2 weeks, in my opinion. And if you agree, your opinion was far more than mine. but I thought they were. And so you're the better team the first 2 weeks, but until you get the win, the win's – it's harder to get them to waterfall until you get one. Now you got one, and now you can say, okay, now let's see what we can do.
Yeah, it's always hard to keep selling hope when you get close, right? Mm-hmm. Because then the narrative becomes, well, they just don't know how to win, which is such a fictional thing. It's all in your brain. Like, knowing how to win is just going out and making the plays that you do in practice, and then you've been doing the whole game. It's just as crunch time comes close, all of a sudden in your mind, your body starts to tense up just a little bit, right? Because you don't have that confidence to keep playing loose. And so the more it happens, the more it builds, right? And so to finally be able to break through and in the manner that they broke through, to be able to come back from a deficit like that on Thursday Night Football, a national audience, with a guy like Baker who has that confidence, that's going to instill confidence in every member in that locker room.
No, it absolutely is. Let's talk about some of the other things that really got it done. Myles Garrett was just a beast. I mean, he was just a beast in this game. I mean, the Jets did not have an answer for him. Joe, the way he can impact, and this speaks to the large part of the amount of playmakers now that Greg Williams has at his mm-hmm. disposal. I know you saw Denzel Ward with the strip, but also when the Jets in the first half are running the receiver screen and Denzel sniffs it out, loss of three on third down, they're out. He's got three takeaways in three games as the fourth pick in the draft. You have him, you have Miles, you have a defense now, Joe, that three straight weeks has made NFL quarterback, Sam being the rookie, of course, but two Hall of Famers before that, look just uncomfortable, and it was more on display last night.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing what those guys on defense are doing right now, the way they're taking the ball away, the way they're flying all over the field. But let me tell you, Myles Garrett had an impact on that game that wasn't seen in the stats mm-hmm. right away until after the game. And I was doing the game for NFL Network on Thursday Night Football, and I was talking to our researcher in the third and fourth quarter, and I said, hey, look up how many times Sam Darnold has dropped back and thrown the ball more than a bubble screen. Mm-hmm. You know, all night, all he was throwing was quick screens and bubble screens. Why was that? Because the Jets offensive coordinator was deathly afraid of dropping Sam Darnold back and letting Myles Garrett get after that New York Jets offensive line that has struggled a little bit at this point in the season. And they were so deathly afraid of what happens when Sam Darnold gets pressure and the interceptions that he throws and the turnovers that he makes when he is under pressure that they just didn't let him throw it all the whole night. Every single one of his throws. I think at one point in the almost the third quarter, he'd only had like – three passes that went more than 10 yards.
Right.
I didn't see what the final chart was, but it was totally amazing. The number of times that he dropped back for an NFL quarterback was almost zero in going into like the fourth quarter.
And that's what 95 does.
And that's what he does. He instills fear and he changes your game plan.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's just defensively was solid. Again, you get the two picks that iced the game at the end. How about the day for Carlos Hyde? So we induce labor, we race and play a game, we play the game, and then we go have the boy.
Unbelievable.
This is nuts. And
on
then he has his best game.
Yeah.
Right, on his birthday. He has the best game he's had. And Joe, you saw him. What I think I covered him at Ohio State, and you saw what we saw when he was at Ohio State was just a decisive, violent runner that, like, there was no doubt in my mind that he was scoring the touchdown.
Yep.
On third down. Zero. I mean, there's just no doubt that he was going to get it in. That's just what he does. Mm-hmm. That's just who he is. And you saw what type of player he can be. Can you imagine the day he had?
Wow.
On a Thursday?
Wow.
First son?
Can you imagine the emotions that were going through his body?
No.
The chemical emotions that were going through his body from, all right, I'm going to have this baby now so that I can get to the game. And then, uh-oh. It didn't work. The baby's not here yet. I better go run and go play a game real quick and then come back. Let me tell you a quick story. So it was like my eighth year or so. Kyle Shanahan was a coordinator. Mike Pettine's first game. My second daughter was due the day of the game. The opener. It was the away opener. The first game of the
first
season
game of the year.
In Pittsburgh.
Okay.
And so I had a lot of nervousness going into it. Obviously, I'm like, I don't want to miss the birth of my child. That is clearly, to me, more important than going to this game. But you know what? This first game of the season against the Steelers is pretty important.
Big deal.
So I kind of don't want to miss this one. So we had actually come up with a plan where one of our director of football ops guys, Simon, the great one-man army, Simon Gielon, was going to have a car that was ready in Pittsburgh, like turned on and ready to go,
okay.
That if I got the call at any point, either the night before the game or at whatever point, like before the game or after the game, where they could race me to Cleveland, like police escort, I could see the baby and then I could go right back and go back to the game in Pittsburgh. So if it was, 3 a.m, I was going to be there and we were going to pump the Pitocin before the game to get that baby out. And if for some reason the game had started, they were going to do everything they can to keep that baby in so that I could jump in the car as soon as the game was over and go see the birth of the baby. But thankfully, the baby was about a week late, and she was born during the next week of practice, so I missed a couple days. But never missed the game, thankfully, because that was such a fear of mine. Like at that point, I had like a little bit of a snap streak going, and you don't want to let your team down, obviously, but they understand. But you want to be there, right?
Yeah.
And you'd hate to have a streak that was going on at that time, 8 or 9 years without missing a play, ended because you're having a baby. I mean, more important having a baby.
Sure.
But still.
No. I see. And I was curious, like, you were down there last night. I don't know. How did he get out of there? Did he have a chopper? How would he get? I mean, there were so many
people.
I took
Bob Wiley's chopper out of there.
He's got
Black
a chopper
Hawk,
too.
One.
He's got like
Marine One.
Marine One.
He took me out of there.
It wouldn't surprise me if he did have Marine One. But I wonder, like, how Carlos got out. That was just a sea of humanity. And Joe, look, obviously, you are one of the pillars of this organization. And when I'm watching these videos that have gone viral of people going through the gates on the way out and chanting and screaming and celebrating. Mm. And by the way, pretty good job out of you, Bud Light. That's kind of winning the day, I would say, with that, right?
Bud Light did pretty good.
Yeah,
Their marketing guy should get a big boost in his Christmas bonus.
Yeah.
More than a Jelly of the Month Club this year.
You got Baker saying dilly dilly on the post. I mean, that's a pretty good job out of them. They won the night certainly as well. But, Joe, you know what it means, these fans. And can you put into perspective what you saw post-game last night?
I'm going to answer that with one word, no, because it was so overwhelming emotionally to watch those fans and to know what they've been putting up with and how they continue to show up. They continue to tune in. They continue to follow the team that they love because it's just woven in the fabric of who they are. Growing up in Northeast Ohio, you are a Cleveland Brown.
Mm-hmm.
It's so special. I was doing the post game and with Baker, and I was tearing up a little bit. I'm glad I was able to hold it together because I do tend to get a little emotional after wins.
We've seen your viral reactions. Yeah.
And I, for some reason, I just can't control the waterworks sometimes. But I was sitting up there on stage, and there was hundreds of fans that were sticking around on the NFL Network set just to watch Baker. And I don't even think they could listen to what we were saying, but they were just there.
Joe, they didn't leave.
And there was this older guy. He was older. He was probably in his late 50s, 60s. And he had his shirt off. And he didn't have like a shirt off type body, but he was swinging it around. And he looked like he was the happiest guy. That was the happiest that guy's been at least 20 years.
Yeah.
And it was like, I'm pretty sure these guys are reacting as if we won the Super Bowl. And most people that are outside of Cleveland be like, dude, you guys just won one game. You know, yeah. Act like you've been there. But we haven't been there for a while.
No.
And it feels so good. And I knew exactly how that guy was feeling. So I took a picture of him, and I'm going to throw him up on my Twitter page because he deserves it. And when we were throwing out shirts after the game, yeah. I made sure to give him one because he looked like he needed one. Yeah,
need
for the way home. Because I'm not sure if he knew where his shirt was.
No. That was great. Look, we're going to talk more about Baker coming up next. We're going to get you involved as well because this is everybody's win, right? So get on the line. You want to weigh in. You got questions for Joe. We would be happy to take you. This is a win for Northeast Ohio. It's a win for Ohio. It's a win for Browns fans and perhaps a glimpse into what's to come. We want to thank Rally's for being here. Great food drop out of them. All sorts of great grub. We've been devouring it. The boneless wings, the burgers, all of it. Excellent job out of them. Coming up next. Baker Mayfield, and where does he go from here? Is a franchise quarterback been established for the Cleveland Browns? We do that next, off and running on a Victory Friday. Enjoy it, kids, right here on CBD 850 WKNR.